Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Dear viewers, welcome back once again to our regular weekly program Islam and Life. This is the last segment of our today's program. We are discussing and listening lectures from our Shaykh about major sins. Today's topic was disobeying parents. Without further delay, we'll get back to our Shaykh. But before that, I would like to remind you that you can call us on our given number at the screen 0207-096-0405. We'll take your questions and our Shaykh will answer it accordingly. Let's get back to our Shaykh. Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you for being here again. And today we're listening lectures from you about disobeying parents. I would like to request you to continue that,
please. Barakallah, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dear parents, respective viewers, with regards to the jinn issue, I'd like to make one thing more clear as well.
Please.
That many a times people have this thinking that they are possessed or somebody is possessed with a jinn.
So it's a correlation with the previous answer you given in the last segment.
Yeah, inshallah. So at that time, should not have any doubts. Similarly, people have regarding the jinns, they have a phobia that there's so much fearful regarding the jinns. It shouldn't be the case as well. As we have so much phobia regarding the jinns, jinns are also, they have the fear regarding us. Therefore, we should not have this kind of phobia regarding us, especially children at night, and especially sisters sometimes, they get this phobia. It shouldn't be the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should have trust on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have help us, inshallah.
Barakallah. Jazakallah, Shaykh. I think we have a caller on the line.
Inshallah.
Let's take the call. Assalamu alaikum, dear caller.
Yeah, assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to speak. I have one question.
Please, brother.
Today, and nowadays, is, you know, is very frustrating because, you know, so many alim ulama, and, you know, they are giving different perception of different, you know, on an Islam basis, you know, some, because I just wanted to make one question, that is, that if anyone do the Farz Namaz only, and if he leads the Sunnah Namaz, then is it going to be sin? Because some of the imams, they say, if you do your Farz Namaz, and if you don't do the Sunnah, then you it won't be harm, because you do the Farz. Other imams, they say, no, you will have a punishment for the...
Okay.
You will have a sin
I think,
for the
Sunnah. I think, thank you, brother. I think we got your questions. Do you have any other questions?
And another question is, it's not a question, it's a compliment.
Yeah.
Because the Shaykh in here, I really, really like him. He's one of the, I have some of the Shaykh, I really like them. He's one of them because he makes the answer so nicely and so elaborately.
Jazakallah.
My heart saying that may Allah give him neck health and may Allah give him all
Inshallah. Inshallah. We pray for the same. We pray for the same. We are very happy to have him here today, and we'll continue this show. Thank you, brother. Thank you very much for your complimentary questions, Sheikh. As the brother asked about the
sunnah of the salat,
and also he mentioned one very important aspect of Islam and today's opinions about the sheikhs, about the imams, and the. Could you put some light on that?
Jazakumullah, barakallah. Jazakallah, brother, for the very nice, mashallah, comments you have made. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us better and good as you are thinking regarding us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite us all in Jannah, Jannatul Firdaus, in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. With regards to the sunnah, which are compulsory sunnah before the Farz Salah and after Salah, with regards to them, without kind of like falling into any kind of debate, just look into the saying, into the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What was the saying and practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? If you look at that, then inshallah we'll get a satisfactory answer. The answer is, Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he himself always prayed this sunnah before and after the salah. It wasn't any case in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam willfully, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam willingly has missed those sunnah. Once or twice Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes in the hadith that he could not do them. Therefore, what happened? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam missed them. For example, once Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so busy distributing the wealth of booty amongst the people. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could not pray his two rakat of Zuhr Sunnah, which are after Zuhr Salah. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed these two rakat of Zuhr Salah, Zuhr Sunnah, after Asr Salah.
And he was with, not even in his own place, he went to...
It was in Madinah al-Munawwara. Okay. It was in Madinah al-Munawwara. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed them after Asr. What does it indicate? That these are so rewardable acts, they should not be left out like that. Therefore, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to perform them continuously. And this is why in the term of Sharia, these are known as as-sunnah al-ratiba, sunnatul ratiba, wa as-sunnah al-mu'akkada, the emphasized sunnah or continuously practiced sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, as far as the farad is concerned, my brother, that if you have prayed your farad salah, you have done your duty. Okay, but as far as the sunnah are concerned, they are to complete the shortcomings in our faraid, in our compulsory salah. Therefore, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray them, and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam physically, practically as well, he has emphasized on them, and verbally Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in the hadith that whoever prays 12 raka'ah during the day, which are the sunnah muakkida, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build a house for him in Jannah.
Subhanallah.
So who doesn't want a house built for him in Jannah? A reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, ulama, they have said, because these are the strong sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we should not ever neglect this sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we should pray them before each and after each salah, as they are proven accordingly from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thirdly, in another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, the first account Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take from the action of the servants on the day of judgment, it will be regarding his salah. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is satisfied with the salah of a person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then deal with this person leniently. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he is not satisfied with the salah, then you can understand what will be the consequences. Therefore, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, أَوَّلُ مَا يُحَاسَبُ بِهِ الْعَبْدُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ الصَّلَاةِ. The first thing a person will be questioned by Allah Azza wa Jalla on the day of judgment is regarding his salah. Secondly, another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, Allah ta'ala, when taking the account regarding the salah, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if the servant has a bit of shortfalling in his compulsory salah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then tell the angels, look for my servant. Does he have any optional salah? If the servant has any optional salah, then the shortfalling he has regarding the first salah, try to fulfill that place with the optional salah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Now you can imagine if by negligence a person is not praying this salah, and in the hereafter he has a bit of shortfalling in his first salah, how important this optional salah will be to fulfill the shortfalling which he has regarding his compulsory salah. Therefore, it is always wise, it is always worthy praying this compulsory, praying this optional salah, which are known as sunnat-e-mu'akkida or sunnat-e-ratiba, which are proven from the sahih ahadith and saying in actions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I hope the brother has understood,
yes,
inshallah.
Yes, jazakallah, Shaykh. I would like to put a one word onto that. The Shaykh who said about the sunnah, who mentioned this prayer, the sunnahs and this prayer, they put the priorities, importance of the sunnahs, not to make them disobeying by the ummah, I think, could you please say? Because the Shaykhs said, because Fajr means it's the most prioritized prayer and the wajib than the sunnah.
Okay, so as far as salah is concerned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made five compulsory daily prayers. Okay, these are at the five due times, Zuhr, Fajr, Zuhar, Asr, Maghrib and Isha. And the number of salah within them, the compulsory ones are there. In Fajr, we have two compulsory ones, which is two rak'ah. In Zuhar, four. In Asr, four. In Maghrib, three. Isha, four. That's it. Okay, these are the compulsory.
The 14 in total.
Okay. But before them and after them, Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to recite some of the sunnah, which are known as sunnat muakkida. He never used to miss them. Mm-hmm. Therefore, ulama, when they have discovered them in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because of the emphasis, practical and the verbal emphasis of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ulama, they have said these are the sunnat ratiba, these are the sunnat muakkida, because Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray them. A person should not neglect them; he should pray them. And then ulama, they say, if a person builds the courage of missing the sunnah, then he will have the courage of missing the farad as well. Therefore, a person should not miss the sunnah which are proven from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Jazakallah, Shaykh. Thank you very much for clarifying that. We have a call on the line. Let's take the call. Assalamu alaikum, caller. Sorry, we lost the caller. Please call up. We lost you. Could you please call back again? Sheikh, yes, continue with our topic.
Yeah. Inshallah, we'll come back to our topic now. Yes. The major sins. And from the major sins, it's like an umbrella topic. And from that, we are covering one of the major sins, which is disobeying parents. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَاحِبُهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. If the parents were to be, na'udhu billah, may Allah protect non-Muslims, committing shirk with Allah or kufr with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if they were to command you something against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at that time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, do not obey them. But on top of that, Allah Ta'ala has said, وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. But still your parents, if they are non-Muslims, then treat them nicely. وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا. Treat them in the worldly life, مَعْرُوفًا, in a very nice, in a good conduct, in a good manner. So this is the Quranic concept regarding respecting the parents. Now come to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That what did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in the hadith? In one of the hadiths, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was mentioning to the Sahaba regarding some of the grave and the major sins. And then in that hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the habit of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was that when Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would teach the Sahaba, he would adopt many different styles. Sometimes Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would put the question first and bring the answer from the Sahaba. And sometimes he will say, shall I not do this for you? Shall I not inform you? Shall I not tell you? In order to draw the full attention of the Sahaba. Or sometimes Prophet ﷺ would do so in order to make the thing, express the importance of the thing to the Sahaba. So in one gathering, Prophet ﷺ was sitting in the company of the Sahaba, ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. Prophet ﷺ said, Ala unabbi'ukum bi akbaril kaba'ir. This hadith is found in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, shall I not inform you regarding the most major sin, akbarul kabair? One is akbar, major, and kabair, majors. So one is the most grave sin out of the grave sins. Allahu Akbar. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, shall I not inform you regarding one of the major sin out of the many major sins? Or one of the most dangerous major sin out of the major sins.
So it's very severe.
Very severe. Why Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned it like that? Because the reality is this is a severe sin. Many a times people take the rights of the parents very lightly. Are you with me? Na'udhu billah, may Allah protect. They many times they think that the parents, okay, their life is only to give birth. That's it. Their job is only to give birth. Once they have given, they have given. Why should I respect them? Na'udhu billahi min zalik.
They take them granted.
Na'udhu billahi min zalik. It is not the case like that. A sahabi comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who should I respect more? And the three times Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ummak, ummak, ummak. Your mother, your mother, your mother. And the fourth time Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, your father. Okay, inshallah, take the call.
Yes, we have a call on the line. Let's take the call. Assalamu alaikum, caller.
Walaikum assalam.
Yes, sister, please.
I have a question.
Yes.
If someone doing istikhara namaz, but they can't find any sin in their dream, what they do after that?
Okay, Zazakallah, sister. Thank you very much for your question. Do you have any other question?
Walaikum assalam.
I think, yeah.
MashaAllah.
It's
so let's just give the answer after that. Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the importance regarding the rights of the parents. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, shall I not, the sahabi asked that who should I show my respect to three times. For the three times he responded, ummak, 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 your mother, your mother, your mother. Why? The mothers, they go through such difficulties in the life of the child that no one else can ever think of doing so. Number one, the 40 weeks of the pregnancy. Number two, the delivery pain. And number three, after the birth, the breastfeeding for two or two and a half years. Allahu Akbar Kabira. So therefore, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, these are the three difficulties the mother goes through for each child. No one else in the world share these three pain with the
mother.
Therefore, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that respect your mother, respect your mother, respect your mother. So because of the respect of the mother's parents, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, shall I not inform you regarding the most dangerous grave sin, Akbarul Kabair? Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim, when they said, Ya Rasulullah, of course, please inform us. We need to refrain from that, because the sins are those ones which take a person towards the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we need to learn from you, and we need to stay away from that. We need to have the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in that hadith of Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, he replied that Akbarul Kabair is Uququl Walidain. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied that the most grave and dangerous sin is to disobey the parents. Now, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has used the Arabic word uquq. Uquq comes from the Arabic word aqqa. And aqqa literally means when the dog barks.
Oh.
So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, refrain from barking like the dog with the parents. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Second meaning of the word aqqa, to cut. Refrain from cutting the relationship with the parents anyhow. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that one of the grave sin is to cut the relation with the parents, disobeying the parents, disrespecting the parents, abusing the parents, etc., etc. The sister has asked a very nice question regarding istikhara. And it is sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that if a person is not 100% sure regarding anything he wants to do, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, make a istikhara. Istikhara means seeking good from Allah subhanahu. Istikhara comes from the Arabic word khair. Khair means good, and istikhara means seeking good. So if a person, if the thing is legal according to Sharia, it is not one of those things which is not legal according to Sharia. If the thing is legal, then making istikhara to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, if a person wants to do a business in a halal way, if a person wants to get married to a person, etc., etc. So these are the legal things in the Sharia. Now, is there any good in doing so? Okay, or asking good in that thing, in that particular thing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is known as istikhara. If a person has done any istikhara, then there is no need for seeing any sign. That you have to see a sign, any kind of indication from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to continue with this action, there is no need for that. If the thing is legal and you have done the istikhara, you have asked from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you good in that particular thing, then inshallah this is sufficient. You don't have to see anything in it, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you the good, inshallah.
Jazakallah, Shaykh. Thank you very much. So, may I ask, continue with these questions.
Yeah.
Like, how many days, if you want to see something, if you want to like do the istikhara, how many days do you recommend?
There is no limitation. Until you get satisfied, you can do it. You can do once, twice, thrice. Until you are satisfied, you can do it, no problem. There is no limitation to it.
Okay. Jazakallah, Shaykh. Thank you very much.
Inshallah.
So we'll continue with the
barakallah, barakallah. So in that hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that cutting the relation, breaking the kinship with the parents, cutting the relation with the parents, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned that as to be one of the most grave and dangerous sins. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, ridallahi fi ridal walidi wa sakhtullahi fi sakhtil walidi. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that if you want to have the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it lies in the pleasure of your father. And the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it lies in the wrath of your own father. What does it mean? That if the father is telling you something which is not against Quran and Sunnah, something which is not harmful to you, something which is not evil in the society, okay? And if you are fulfilling that, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of fulfilling the command of the parents, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also grant you reward. And if the parents, they are telling you of anything which is against the command of Allah, which is against the society, which is against the good conduct, which is harmful for the health, which is bad for the society, that you should not do that, and a person does it, then this is from the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because of him doing it, this person will fall into the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This person will fall into the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in this hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given the right of the father. That as far as the father is concerned, that you have to maintain the pleasure of the father as well, that if the father is pleased with something with you, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased, and if the father is upset with you regarding something, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upset with you. So as far as the parents are concerned, either the father or the mother, they both have to be respected, and they are both, the rights of the both has to be given and paid. This is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in another hadith, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is the time we are going through, my brothers and my sisters, as the more the day of judgment is drawing near, we are going towards the destruction. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned all the signs of the day of judgment. All the signs. And all the signs which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned, the minor ones, they already happened. Only full handful, the major ones, they are remaining. In one of the hadiths, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned the one of the sign of the day of judgment will be that a person will be close to his friends, distance from his father.
Oh.
Now, do I need to elaborate anything on this one?
No.
Subhanal Malik al-Qudus, it is such an obvious sign which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned. That nowadays, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect, many times people call their father old man. They call their mothers old lady. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect, many a time children being heard, they swear at their own parents. They swear at their own mothers. Okay? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, before the day of judgment, people will be far away from their parents, from their fathers, and they will be close to their friends. They will listen to their friends. They will obey their friends. They will try to satisfy their friends. As I said earlier on in the first segment, when they talk, they have a very nice, smart way of talking. Smile on the face. Even if they're online, they will text them as well with a smile on the face. But when it comes to talking to the parents face to face, Allahu Akbar Kabira, no smile on the face, gloomy, moody, etc., etc. It's like this person has never smiled in his life. But when he is with the friend circle, he's the best person. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, before the day of judgment, one of the signs of the day of judgment is that a person will be away from his parents. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then said, you be away from the parents, it's not going to harm the parents, it's you who is going to be harmed. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then said, Al-walidu awsatu abwaabil jannah. The father, he is the middle gate to Jannah. If you want to go into paradise, the father, he is the middle gate. He is the best gate to paradise, to Jannah. If you want to walk to the Jannah peacefully, then make sure your father, he is pleased and kind with you. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَإِنْ شِيْتَ فَحْفَظْ وَإِنْ شِيْتَ فَضَيَّعْ. If you want to preserve your gate to Jannah, then make sure you keep your parents happy. And if you want to destroy your gate to Jannah, make sure you make your parents upset. I think we didn't have the time anymore. Time has run out.
No, yeah, time has run out. Thank you, Shaykh. Jazakallah. I would like to thank you on behalf of our audience. Thank you for bringing this topic, and thank you for giving a lecture.
Inshallah,
about
I think we'll continue with
the Inshallah, we'll continue. Inshallah. It's time for finish today. It's time. Dear viewers, time's up. Today we tried to discuss as many as we could. We'll continue this topic next week, Inshallah, with our Honorable Shaykh. Thank you. I'd like to thank you from bottom of our heart for being with us, to be our audience and put your important questions to us. See you next week, the same time, Inshallah. Till then, take care. Jazakallah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.